How are you guys doing tonight? This is Felonious Bitcoin here. My name is Matt. I'm coming at you guys with another video tonight regarding, you know, the government and their corruption and everything else going on.
It's just
on.
So bizarre.
But
so
mainly,
un-American.
I just want to go across a couple of topics that were they interested me, and they might interest you as well. I don't know, but we'll find out. So I basically wanted to talk to you guys about national emergency. If that was to happen, which I think Trump pretty much said that's what's going to happen, martial law could come into effect. And what that breaks down into, if you guys are wondering, it means that you will have a curfew. You have to be at home or at work. You don't have any freedom to go out at night. And you're only allowed to go out like during designated times. So I think that should be pretty concerning to some people out there. If you guys like your freedom. So the next thing is restrictions on your movement. Passports and licenses can be revoked without cause. Yeah.
Oh my God.
Isn't that a nice little nifty tool that the government has in their back pocket in case they want to use? So there's that. Suspension of all civil liberties. What does that mean, basically? Well, I'll tell you. So you have suspension of habeas corpus. That's pretty important. Suspension of your Second Amendment rights to carry a firearm. I'm not sure if you guys know what that means, but you're basically unallowed to protect yourself if, you know, ever caught for it. So say goodbye to those rights. They will take them away. You know what I mean? They'll come to your house. If they know that you have a registered firearm in your name, they're coming for it. So you better watch out. And if you're concerned about it, I would say to report them lost or stolen. I mean, that's just what I would do. But like, okay, so the next thing, martial law is the imposition of a direct control over normal civilian functions of government used to in response to a temporary emergency, an invasion, or major disaster, or within an occupied territory. So basically, that means that government can have complete control over you, no matter what the situation is, if martial law is enacted. So you guys definitely want to watch out for that. The next thing, application of military law to civilians. I pretty much just said that. State of emergency can be used to engage in war without congressional approval. That means, but if I had to guess, I would say that means that we're fucked and you guys better get in, you know, under the ground in your bunkers if that was to happen. I mean, if you guys ever heard on the news or through any kind of media outlet, you know, that we might be going to war with China, it might be a pretty damn good idea to start stocking up on necessities and, you know, preparing. I mean, I know the government doesn't like to hear that word, preparing. It's like, you know, stigma. Preparing? No, we can't have that. We need people to die.
So,
you guys want to prepare? Don't let anyone know you're doing it, except the people that you really care about. Moving on from that, you also have to... land and resources can be turned into federal property by decree. So that means that any land that you own, legitimately, legally... that you pay taxes on can be, you know, forfeited from you to the government's control, which means that you no longer have any say over your dwelling, your things, or anything inside of your house or properties. So that basically means that if the governments feel the need, you know, and they feel the, you know, the urge to take your stuff or whatever it is that you own for whatever reason, they're able to do it. And
I
what
want
are you going
to
do? Stop them? I don't think so. You don't have automatic weapons like they do, even though the Second Amendment kind of is for that reason, but yeah, I must be crazy. But like, okay, so moving on, they can take your house and make you leave, legally allowing them to take what
Give
you
it
have.
To me now.
It's a fact. I mean, you guys can go and look this stuff up. Inability to access the internet or substantially limiting information that people can access. Meaning no more freedom of press.
What's going on here?
Silence!
No more free news.
Silence!
It will become a propaganda tool of the government. You know, you remember World War II, how they had all their propaganda, but nobody else was able to say anything?
Silence!
Well, there you go. The press, The printing press was basically under their control. And if they found out that anybody was printing, you know, this is, I'm talking during World War II, and I'm saying this because history has a strange, odd way of repeating itself. And this is pretty much, I think, how it's going to happen. Is they will start to tell you things that are not exactly true to certain degrees, and they will lie to you. You know what I mean? They're gonna probably outlaw free press, freedom of speech. To, you know, where when we get to the point where the currency is basically worthless, they don't want anybody to rise up against them. So that's what they'll do. They're gonna start to basically break up crowds of people.
Get the fuck out of here!
In the internet sense, you know, basically if you go on forums or if you go on Facebook, you guys might see ads or postings for certain things, and we're already starting to see it. You know, that's the strange thing, is we're already starting to slowly see these things take effect. You know, where, you know, media outlets aren't able to speak their freedom of speech.
Silence!
Because the government doesn't want it to happen. You know what I mean? They don't want these things to get out.
Silence!
So they ban these accounts, and then they're not able to post, or like on YouTube, they're able to shadow ban your account so that basically nobody can watch your videos. You know what I mean? It's kind of a messed up thing.
We are the true rulers of this planet.
So I just want to go over something else also. A couple of things.
Silence!
Trump's shutdown could hinder tax collectors for months and even years. This was an article made by the Washington Post. It says taxpayer trust in tax system and voluntary compliance have been undermined. Right, that's what I'm reading to you guys right there. So if you guys, you know, feel like looking that up, you're more than welcome. But I'm gonna just read it off real quick and tell you what I think about it, and you guys can tell me what you think. President Trump's partial government shutdown is over, but the haunting effects are not. Perhaps nowhere is that demonstrated more than in the Internal Revenue Service, one agency that affects all Americans. Right? I think we can all agree that taxes affect us all to varying degrees. I think everyone that is watching this video can pretty much agree that these taxes are without representation. So, listen to the words of advocate Nina Olson, an independent official within the IRS. Her latest report describes an agency with a shocking level of service, suffering a cycle of frustration, and one beset with long-standing problems made worse by a 35-day partial shutdown. She described an agency so damaged that taxpayer trust and confidence in our tax system have been crippled. Thank God for that, right? It is irresponsible for an agency that touches all aspects of people's lives to be underfunded, understaffed, and at the mercy of shutdowns, she wrote. It is making strategic decisions that ultimately burden taxpayers, increase its own rework, and create distance and distrust between taxpayers and the tax agency, thereby undermining voluntary compliance. The report provided a slew of statistics demonstrating the depth of the problem. For the last week of the shutdown, ending January 26th, 12.8% of taxpayer calls on installment agreements and balance due questions were answered. Those that were answered waited 93 minutes. The day before the shutdown stopped, the IRS had over 5 million pieces of mail that had not been batched for processing. 80,000 responses to fiscal year 2018 earned income tax credit audits that had not been addressed. 87,000 amended returns waiting to be processed. Metrics like these translate into real harm to real taxpayers, Olson said, and they represent increased rework for the IRS downstream at a time when the IRS is already resource challenged. IRS officials responded with a statement that said the agency successfully reopened operations following the shutdown, and the agency is seeing a good start to the 2019 filing season. We are continuing to assess the impact of the shutdown on our various operations across the agency and remain proud of the many IRS employees who have risen to the resulting challenges. The full impact of the shutdown won't be known for months and even years down the road, Olson predicted. She praised IRS employees who returned to work with energy. I mean, I'm just going to cut that off real quick and say, I don't understand how you could have a job like that and, you know, go home at, you know, after work at night to your family and say, you know, I'm so happy to work for the IRS. You know, because you're basically stealing from everybody. You know what I mean? And there's so many funds that have been, you know, gone, you know, off the books that nobody knows about.
Island.
And it's funny that the IRS, you know, never has to account to anybody for anything, you know, except themselves. It's like, it's one of those things where they're not part of the federal government. They're part of the, like, the Federal Reserve System, if you will. So they control, you know, basically revenue, which is money, right? So Internal Revenue Service, think about that. They're not really providing a service for anybody, because if they did, they wouldn't exist. I mean, think about it. If you want to give out your money to someone for nothing, you know, you basically say, you want to buy something from me, and I want to sell you something. You give me the money, and then along comes the IRS like this, saying, where's my
cut? You got my money?
It's like, huh? This is between you and me, not between you, me, and this douchebag over here. Get out. You know what I mean? So that's what I mean.
Like, have the money by tomorrow, and there won't be any problems.
It's kind of like a theft system. It really is a theft service for the elites. You know what I mean? Because what do they use this money on, I wonder? I want to see accounting for all these dollars that they collect. Hey guys, sorry about that. My my last recording got cut off because my memory card was full for some odd reason. I don't know why, but it was. And so here I am. And yeah, the Internal Revenue Service, I'm not sure what kind of service they're providing, especially to the taxpayers. You know, they talk about it being a burden to the taxpayer and the tax collecting agency. Yeah, the whole entire service is a burden. Why don't you just abolish it and get rid of it? Because it's not necessary, you know? We're supposed to be seeing all these taxes go to roads being fixed here in Massachusetts. And I don't know about you guys, but where I am in Massachusetts, I'm not seeing any of these roads getting fixed. If anything, I'm seeing them get a lot worse, a lot faster. And, you know, when they do come out to fix the roads, I see like 12 guys, right? And this is your taxpayer dollars going to work for you. So keep this in mind. When 12 of these guys working for the city or the state or whatever you want to call it, they come out and they come out to fix these potholes or the, you know, cracks in the road. They have 12 guys and they shut off, like, I'm going to just use an example here. Say you're driving on the highway from, let's say, Cape Cod to, you know, Fall River. And you are leaving Cape Cod. From what I've seen, you know, half of the highway shut down for like a mile and a half stretch where nobody's doing any work. But I see all this road, you know, these cones basically making people get into one lane for at least a mile. Okay. And I'm not seeing any work being done where this road is. And I know they must have to do it for, like, whatever reason. Like, you know, basically, like, because you're going 65 miles an hour, you want to make sure people can merge. But, like, you don't need a whole mile to do that. You know what I mean? You maybe need a quarter of a mile and give people that, like, blinking, you know, arrow that tells them get over to the left or get over to the right. And you also have the state police. They're getting funded just to sit there, basically. And then you have the 12 guys that are there to do the work on the side of the highway or on the road or whatever. And there's like three of them doing the actual work. And then eight or nine guys just standing around shooting the shit. You know what I mean? So this is what your tax dollars are paying for. People just stand around and take breaks. You know what I mean? This is what I'm talking about. It's such an inefficient system to the point where it needs to be completely torn down and rebuilt. And my best guess, and I'm no genius by any means, so I don't think I know what I'm talking about when it comes to everything, but, you know, you guys do your own research and you look into things for yourselves and you come to your own conclusions, you know? But I think that gold and silver is the absolute monetary system of all time. You can't beat it. You know what I mean? It has a finite supply, can't be duplicated. It doesn't stop working if the electricity stops working, you know? And that's what I mean. It's 100% reliable, and there's no way you can't beat it. There's just no way. I urge anybody out there that has a different opinion to post down in the comments section what you guys think is real money, because so far, for over 6,000 years, it's been gold and silver right here. These two precious metals that if you have in your possession, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about when it comes to the wealth that it contains. You can feel it. There's a certain type of energy with each one of these metals, and it makes you feel, you know, like empowered. You know what I mean? I said this in a previous video. But yeah, you guys definitely want to get out of the paper assets. You want to get out of cryptocurrencies, because it's only a matter of time before the internet goes down or gets shut down or is limited to access, or governments have complete control over it like they really do. They're just basically posturing these days to make you think that they don't really have control over it when they actually do. You know, the SHA-256 algorithm that Bitcoin uses was created by the NSA, National Security Agency.
Classified.
You know, who do you think they have a vested interest in?
Classified.
To the people of the country or to the government and the banks?
Classified.
You know, that fund them, that pay them their paychecks. You know, so that's what you have to keep in mind. And how are they doing this? They're backing all their assets up with silver and gold. And that's what you need to do. Back yourself up with silver and gold. That way, if you wake up tomorrow and the monetary system stops working for whatever reason, you can wake up and you have peace of mind. You know what I mean? It's that simple. Knowing that you have these two assets in your possession that can protect you from a financial collapse or financial turmoil, and nobody can take it away from you. If you don't tell anybody about this stuff, nobody's ever going to know about it. You know what I mean? Me making these videos, sure, I'm letting people know I have precious metals. So what? You guys don't know where I live. You don't know where I'm putting it. You don't know where I'm storing it. And even if you did somehow find out, other people that I trust know where it is, you know, and they would know where to look for it before you go and look for it. So, yeah. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I'm not trying to be pompous or anything, even though it might be coming out like that. But you definitely want to protect yourself in these crazy times that we live in. You know what I mean? I've said this in my other videos. You have to look out for yourself. And that's really the only way that anyone can give you the best advice is, you know, you need to do your own research. You need to look out for yourself. You need to find out facts based on your own research. You can't go based on just watching this video or, you know, other people's videos on YouTube. You need to cross-reference and you need to research diligently into these things. If it's what really interests you and it bothers you and it keeps you up at night to think about these things, then I urge you from the bottom of my heart to, you know, do your own research and look into these things for yourself. I mean, this country was founded on great principles. Why do you think that this became the number one country in the world? Because they had great principles. But the greed always has a way of overtaking these principles for some reason. We always seem to let the banks have some sort of control, or let the IMF decide what money is, or let governments tell us what money is, when we really shouldn't. You know what I mean? This is us. This is one human being transacting with another human being to get goods or services in return for some sort of store of value. And why should any third party have any say over this or whatever this is supposed to be referenced to? You know what I mean? If there's terrorists out there that use this stuff, then they should be looking after the terrorists. They should be doing their police work, their due diligence, and finding out who these people are and bringing them to justice. You know what I mean? As opposed to trying to limit everyday normal people's transactions by imposing laws such as the Patriot Act that's able to spy on everybody and basically give the government's control over people's bank accounts. I mean, especially when you've never been convicted of any kind of guilty wrongdoing. You know what I mean? You've never been convicted of terrorism or money laundering or drug trafficking or any kind of illegal activity whatsoever. And yet, if you go and you try to deposit more than $10,000 in the bank, The bank looks at you like you're a criminal. You have to fill out paperwork where you basically report all your money to the government that you're depositing, what it's from, what it's for, and how you obtain this money. It's not their business. If you had a mattress account and you saved your money up for like 20 years and then you go and you try to deposit it, they're just going to seize it because they think that you're tied to some sort of illegal activity. And it strangely enough comes at a time when the country is facing economic collapse. So this just seems to me like another tool to basically tighten down controls and, you know, siphon your wealth off from you. You know, you see the banking system taking percentage gains out of everyone's bank account, lending you money that you put into your account to other people. And if everybody went and tried to withdrew their money at the same time, you wouldn't be able to. You know what I mean? The banks would have a run on them. That's basically where the term bank run comes from. If everyone goes and tries to extract all their money that belongs to them out of the bank at the same time, the banking system would collapse. You know, and that's a scary thought. You know what I mean? Because we all have this notion, this mind control, govern, control, meant of the mind, mind control. Government means mind control. And that's basically what's going on. So if one day all of us decide to wake up from this illusion that they're putting us under, like they have some sort of control over us, you'll notice right away that the world would become a lot better place a lot quicker if people could transact person to person. You know, you look out for yourself, they look out for themselves, and everybody has an equal stake in the game, as opposed to let's limit the amount of guns on this side for, you know, the criminals. You know, that's what they tell you. Gun control is to keep criminals from the guns. But does it ever? You know, how many police shootings have you heard about? How many drug dealers have you heard about with guns? How many people have guns that shouldn't? You know what I mean? These are the questions you need to ask yourself. How hard is it to obtain a gun illegally? Not very hard. I know, personally, but I'm not going to give any info out on that. But I would say stay the legal route and, you know, use it to your advantage. You know what I mean? Use the law to your advantage. Look into things and find out what works for you. Because from one state to the next, they say that we live in the United States, but however, keep this in mind, the laws are not united in the same way that they call these states. So that's very important to keep in mind, especially if you live up north, where they're trying to tighten down on gun control and basically disarm everybody so that way nobody can protect themselves in the event of, like, say, a home invasion. Recently, there was a home invasion in Dartmouth, actually a couple of towns over, and I'm gonna share that with you guys so you guys can get the full story on this. Home invasion, Dartmouth, right? So basically, this guy, he was at home with his disabled son. This was 2 days ago, right? He's at home with his son. Dartmouth man injured, fighting off suspects during home invasion, right? So, Dartmouth. A 65-year-old Dartmouth man was injured Wednesday when he fought off armed attackers in a home invasion at his Gibson Terrace residence. The four men who forcibly entered his home stole money and jewelry, including a gold necklace, said the victim, who agreed to an interview with the Standard Times. The victim, who is not being identified, lives in the house with his 42-year-old son, who is paralyzed. The victim suffered several cuts to his forehead and face, including about a 1-inch gash to the right side of the forehead. When he was struck with the butt of the barrel of a handgun, he was using a tissue to stop the bleeding from the wound to his forehead as he spoke with a reporter. The front of his white t-shirt was covered in blood spatter. Dartmouth police confirmed in a news release they responded to the home invasion about 10:20 a.m. Police said four men were involved and one brandished a handgun. Police did not confirm other details the victim provided. The incident is being investigated by Dartmouth detectives and uniform officers. You know, good luck with that. The victim said he was struck with the gun when he fought back with the baseball bat. If I had a gun, I would have shot them all, he said. I was scared for my son, who is paralyzed. Now, let me just interject for a second on this note. I understand gun control is meant to keep people safe to some degree, but it doesn't work. You know what I mean? 9 times out of 10, it does not work. All it does is disarms the normal law-abiding citizen and discourages them from having a gun in their possession because they know that the laws are strict. However, criminals, on the other hand, don't really care about what the laws say or what's going to happen to them if they ever get caught. You know, so that's where my premise comes from. And not just that, but he was saying that he was scared for his son who was paralyzed, right? And had he had a gun, he would have been able to shoot them. Let's just put this into perspective for a second. If you're a man watching this video and you're married or you have a girlfriend and you have kids, let me just put this scenario into play for you guys and let me see what you guys respond. You know, as much as you guys might not like guns in the hands of people because of the dangers that they might present, I have a pretty concrete argument to that. When you call 911, you have to wait, right? You get put on hold for maybe 30 seconds. And in those 30 seconds, the criminal that's already in your house, invading your home with a gun, is not going to wait for the police to show up. So that's just one point. The next point I'm going to make is that, you know, if you do get through to dispatch before the person breaks into your house and does whatever harm he has intended for your family, whether it's to rob you or to do some sort of ill intent towards your family, you're still not going to have time for the police to get there in a timely manner in order to stop him. So how do you fight somebody with a gun in your house? It's simple. You need to arm yourself. You need to have a gun, you know. That's basically what it comes down to. You need to be self-sufficient. You can't let the law dictate what's right and wrong for you personally, because the law and what's doing the, when it comes to the law and doing the right thing, those things don't always see eye to eye. You know what I mean? So that's where the problems come from. And it's a money extracting system. So, you know, when they try to disarm people, it's for a reason, and it's not to keep people safe. It's actually to give criminals the upper hand in a situation where you would be helpless. You know, put this into play, right? You're the man in the house, and you have kids, and you have a girlfriend, and you might be opposed to guns because your girlfriend's opposed to guns, or her grandmother, or whatever the case, or you might have had a bad experience when you were younger. I don't know, but let's just say for posterity's sake that a man is intending to break into your house, and you don't have a gun. Are you just gonna let this guy come into your house with an assault rifle? You're gonna let him come into your house, rape your family, rape your daughter, rape your fiance, your wife, whatever the case, murder you, murder them, and, you know, just to follow the law? I'm sorry, but when it comes down to survival, I think the answer is pretty simple. And the answer is that you need to keep control of your situation. You can't count on the government. You can't count on the police. The only person that you can actually absolutely count on is yourself. And I would say if somebody comes into your house with a gun and you don't have the rights to own a gun and you're not registered to have a firearm in the state of Massachusetts, I'm just saying as an example, because I'm not personally, because of some incident that happened when I was 18, and I'll get into that later. So if you can't obtain a gun in the state of Massachusetts for whatever reason, my advice would be to go to another state that has less strict gun rules and get a gun for yourself. You know what I mean? Do what you need to do to protect your family. You know, it might not happen today. It might not happen tomorrow. Hell, it might never happen. But on that off chance that that one time, that one person that has ill intent in that moment decides to come across your house and across your family, you want to be prepared. And I don't know any other way to say it, how to describe this to you guys to make you understand the gravity of the situation. Because we're living in tough times now, you know, with the currency collapsing all over the world, governments having shutdowns, they can't see eye to eye on anything. The police, they can't do anything. You know what I mean? You see all this drug control, the opioid epidemic, and look at how well that worked out with the rules. So there you go. See, that's what rules get you, is more people breaking the rules because they see that there's an opportunity. You know what I mean? Whenever something is banned or forbidden, it becomes like that, that, you know, that fruit that you just want to have that you're not supposed to. Kind of like Adam and Eve, right? You eat the fruit from the tree. But anyways, besides that, off topic, you need to protect your family. And you need to do it in any way that you can, especially now. But this, I need to shut the video off and record again because my card is running out of memory. So hold on a second. Yeah, so you guys need to protect yourselves. Yeah, I'm back, by the way. So you guys need to protect yourselves. You need to get a gun. You need to buy ammo. Stock up on as much as you can. Hide it if you need to. Put it in your bedroom, you know. And I would say, I live in Massachusetts. I don't have a gun in Massachusetts. However, I do have other means to protect myself in the case of a home invasion. And I'd say that you guys need to improvise as much as possible. If guns are off the list, I would say to look into household chemicals of some sort to make sort of some sort of incendiary device. You know what I mean? To protect yourself in the case that somebody breaks into your house with a gun with bad intentions. That's your house. That's your dwelling. You know, that's where you sleep at night. That's where your children sleep at night. And that's what matters. And if somebody is there that's not supposed to be there, I don't think the law has any say over what you can and can't do when somebody comes through that door that you don't authorize them to come through that door. You know what I mean? So I think you have the right as a human being to protect yourself in any way possible, even if that means having a gun illegally. Ooh, I said it. Ooh, illegal guns. Ooh, like the criminals can't find them. Come on now, let's be honest. And that's what I'm talking about. Like, if the criminals can find these guns easier than normal law-abiding citizens, then I'd say that these laws need to be torn down and restructured. You know what I mean? I can understand doing background checks. I agree with that. Do background checks. If somebody's a violent criminal and has a history of, like, I don't know, beating their wife, or a woman has a propensity to, like, hit her man for whatever, then I would say that these people should not have guns. You know what I mean? It's that simple. And I mean, if you want to take it even a step further than that, yeah, I have a felony record, not for anything violent, not for threatening anybody, for hacking cable modems, and for having a gun when I was 18 years old, when my girlfriend bought it for me as a gift in New Hampshire, where it was legal. You know what I mean? Me being 18 and not knowing the laws that well, I came across state lines with a hunting rifle. Not an assault rifle. A Mossberg 22. You know what I mean? A hunting rifle. And my right to carry firearms in this state, Massachusetts, has now been forbidden indefinitely, forever. I'm now 35, and that's going to stick with me the rest of my life. Do you guys think that's right? I mean, I want to know down in the comment section below what you guys think, because from what I can see and what I see going on all around me, I'm probably one of the most stable people you'll ever come across and most rational when it comes to things. And yet I see all these people outside, you know, these thugs running around, you know, running the streets with their drugs and their hookers or, you know, whatever. And I'm sure they have guns, you know, in their crack house or wherever it is that they came from, whatever hellhole they crawled out of. But I don't have the right to protect myself in my own house with a gun. I don't understand that. I really don't. Because I'm a decent human being. I treat people with respect. And I expect to have that same respect extended to me. You know what I mean? And if somebody doesn't show me that respect, I need to be on guard. You know what I mean? I'm sorry if this upsets any of you guys out there, but I feel that I have my own personal right to protect myself. I don't think that it's up to any lawmaker to tell me what I can and can't do to protect myself, especially when these guns are flooding the streets at unprecedented numbers. And, you know, the control, there's no control. You know what I mean? They can't control it. The only control that they posture to you is through the courts. And that's basically when they catch somebody with a gun. They don't know what really goes on the streets. The police do, because they see this shit every day. But, like, as far as the federal government, do you think they really know? And if they do, then I'd say that they're doing this country a disservice by just not doing anything. You know, they know that there's these people out there that risk being terrorists or have, you know, certain types of traits that make them unstable to everyday society. And I would say that those are the people that need to come off the streets. You know what I mean? The people that have a history of violence, you know, they should be taken off the streets. People with short fuses that don't think before they act should be taken off the streets. You know what I mean? And their rights to carry arms should be taken from them. And that's just my honest opinion. Sure, I think that here in America, the founding fathers had a great idea in mind. People have the right to bear arms. Yes, but to some sort of rational degree, sure. I don't think an FID card kind of dictates that, because what do you have to do? You have to go through the police system. You have to basically ask them for permission. And do you think the police want to hand out licenses to carry?
No.
I doubt it, especially here in Massachusetts. But down in Texas, where my brother lives, it's a lot more lax. And I called the sheriff's office and I asked them about me, my own personal situation, because I have a history here in Massachusetts. They said, how long has it been? And I said, it's been 10 years since I've been convicted of any crime. And the last one was when I hacked cable modems. And he said, yeah, you're okay. You know, just, you know, if you ever get pulled over, let the police know you have a gun in the car, and that's it. And it's that simple. You can literally walk around in public with a gun and people don't look at you like you're crazy, because it's expected in a state like that, that has they follow the Constitution for what it means and what it is, as opposed to other states where they misinterpret and they change things, twisting the laws in their direction to basically take your rights away in a slow and steady type way over time. And that's basically what they've done since the introduction of the Constitution, you know. You see all this stuff happening, and it's absolutely no coincidence that this stuff has happened the way it has. It's all been planned, and it's all been done on purpose. The elites have a plan, and that's control and domination over everybody, especially the money system. If you can control people's money, then you can control everything. You know what I mean? Because let's put this into perspective, right? Let's say, for instance, you're the boss of your best friend, right? You guys are best friends. And one day you have to start laying people off, and you tell your best friend, look, your department, it's being downsized for whatever reason. Let's just say for posterity's sake that the economy's collapsing, and you work at Macy's or you work at Sears, and you're the manager of that particular Sears, and you tell the guy working in the shoe department, look, you know, sales are slowing down. You're my best friend. You always have been. But I need you to understand that business is business, and I need to lay you off because, you know, it's coming down from the corporate. You know what I mean? So I'm going to have to let you go. And I'm sorry to say that. You know, obviously the person hearing it is not going to hear it for what it is. They're going to hear, wow, you just screwed me out of a job. I don't have an income now. I can't pay for my rent. I can't pay for my food. I can't pay for my kids' tuition. I can't pay for my fucking toilet paper to wipe my ass. So that's what I mean. When the governments have control over your money, that's when you've given up your power to someone else that doesn't deserve it. The things that you work for should be in your possession and not for somebody else to say what it means. You know what I mean? Especially when it comes to money. The free market should dictate what money really is. Not people, not a government entity. Because look at how much shit has that caused us. you know, World War II, the Roman Empire. I mean, we can backtrack as much as you want. Ever since the introduction of any kind of government. And why do we need it? You know what I mean? If people... people can figure things out for themselves, you know what I mean? There can be a leader in a certain type of group or a certain tribe of people, like say a city as a tribe of people, right? You know, that's your surrounding environment, that's your neighbors, that's the people that know who you are, the people that you know who they are. And if somebody passes through, you know, you look at them and you say, okay, who's this? You know what I mean? Then that's an outsider, you know what I mean? But like within a general vicinity, like I would say city to city, that's how things should be governed. You know what I mean? And I would say that the popular vote between cities should be what it governs the entire nation. You know what I mean? But in an independent kind of fashion, as opposed to these are laws for all the states and that's it. You know what I mean? Because if you're going to call this the United States, let's at least make the laws united to some degree, as opposed to, oh, the laws vary state to state. You know, why do we call this the United States? Please, somebody tell me. I'm waiting for an answer. You know, comment, please. why do we call this the United States? What's the reasoning behind that? You know, it gives people the wrong impression. It gives people the wrong idea. When in fact, the laws are not united. The people between the states are not united in the least. And, you know, you see all this bad blood between the North and the South, or at least it used to be like that. Not so much now, from my own experience, because I went down there and everybody loved me. I told them, you know, and I'll be straight up with you guys, I think that Texas has the best laws when it comes to all the United States. You know, given that they do have, you know, a high degree of, you know, gun deaths, you know, there's a reason for that. You know, there's people that they lose their temper, and sometimes accidents happen. And I think the most important thing when it comes to gun control is education and, you know, safety. You know what I mean? You could be the most excellent sharpshooter in the world, but that doesn't mean anything if your kids don't, if your kids come across these weapons in your house and you don't know how to secure them. You know what I mean? So you need to make sure that you're safe with your guns. You need to make sure you have backups, safety, a safe, locks, something like that. You know what I mean? To make sure that your kids can't get access to them and hurt themselves or somebody else in the household or anybody. You know, if you're the man of the house, I believe it is your duty to have the ultimate control over these weapons, you know, because that's what they are. They're weapons, and they can be used to hurt people. You know, they can be used for good, and they can be used for bad. And I think it's up to the individual to decide what they want to use it for. I believe that there's more good people in the world than bad, and I believe that people would be more willing to work together had it not been for the laws. You know what I mean? Because now all we see is people divided, and that's a government tactic. I've said this before, that they divide and they conquer. You know, they have everybody fighting, oh, make America great again hats, oh, that's fucking racist. You know what I mean? Is it really? Since when? Please name one time that Donald Trump said anything racist. I'll wait for you guys. Please. That's what I mean. We have all these distractions going on, like, oh, I'm transgender. Should I use this bathroom or should I use that bathroom? You know what I mean? And that's the media. You know what I mean? And where does this media shit come from? It comes directly from the government. You know, it's no surprise that the shit that they're up to is basically designed to divide you from your community, from the people that you know, from your family, from everybody, to make you into a debt slave. And to have ultimate control over you, over your mind, and how you think. So, I mean, drugs, media, school, you know, they have all these different things. Religion, you know, that's just four of them off the top of my head, just now, to name a few. And you can just imagine the other ones that they have. You know, we're not even touching on the subject of foods and chemtrails and chemicals that they put into your foods, into McDonald's. And you know, how are these businesses staying afloat if everybody knows that they're bad for you and these people are putting chemicals into their food deliberately that do harm to people, growth hormones that do harm to people? How is it still allowed to continue? Because this government that supposedly has their right hand to God just for you is not doing jack shit about it. That's why. So, I mean, there's a lot of interesting points I find in the Bible. I don't believe in it so much as I do in the actual, you know, the lessons that can be learned from it. Man cannot control man. That's just one. And there's plenty others, you know. And I'm sorry that this video has gone on for way too long. If you guys are not interested in this kind of stuff, then I'm sorry. But if you guys like my content, I would appreciate it if you guys could like, subscribe, you know, get the video, you know, get the word out, share the video. And I would appreciate it. You know what I mean? I'm going to also include my email down below. So if you guys have any questions on, like, you know, if you want to get, like, you know, stock up on MREs, or if you want, like, you know, ideas on, you know, what you would need in the event of an economic collapse, I can help you out with that. And as far as gold and silver goes, you know, these two precious metals right here, I can give you guys a couple of resources. I'll list them down below in the description. I would say that my absolute favorite, and this is just me, is I would say bullion exchanges is my absolute favorite. They have the lowest price over spot opposed to any of the other websites, you know, SD Bullion, all those other ones. and SD bullion, or, you know, JM bullion. There's a couple of them with the J. But yeah, bullion exchanges has the lowest price over spot when it comes to precious metals, I found, personally. I don't go to coin shops because, you know, I can only imagine that if they work in an actual building where people have to go in, they have to pay rent to keep that building open. They have to pay lights, they have to pay employees. So, you know, the price over spot's obviously going to be substantially more. And you don't want to have to mess with that. You know what I mean? Why should you? So I think that's definitely the best resource to go with as far as precious metals goes. But, oh, there was another thing I wanted to talk about. Robert Kraft, the Patriots owner, you guys know him? I'm sure you do. They won the Super Bowl. And I mentioned this in one of my last videos, is that was the worst scoring Super Bowl in history. Robert Kraft, and I'm gonna reference a couple of things for you guys. That way you guys can see what I'm talking about here. Okay, so what I was talking about with Robert Kraft, Kraft Heinz's stock plummets 20% after company slashes dividend, discloses SEC probe, right? And you can see it right there on fortune.com, right? I'm going to just read this to you guys real quick so you can understand what's going on. The stock price of Kraft Heinz plunged 20% late Thursday after the food giant disclosed it received a subpoena from the Securities and Exchange Commission and reported a large net loss due to the reduction of goodwill in some of its best-known brands. Okay. Kraft Heinz also said in a conference call discussing earnings that it cut its quarterly dividend to 40 cents a share from 62.5 cents and that it was considering selling off some of its businesses to help pay down debt. The company reported $30.9 billion in long-term debt at the end of 2018, up from $28.3 billion a year earlier. In its earnings release, Kraft Heinz said it received a subpoena last October related to its accounting policies, procedures, and internal controls related to its procurement function, including but not limited to agreements, signed agreements, and changes or modifications to its agreements with its vendors. I mean, I'm just going to stop right there and, you know, enough with the mumbo jumbo. But I just heard on the news today, and it was breaking news even, that Robert Kraft, the owner of Kraft, Heinz Kraft, he is also being brought up on, soliciting a prostitute. Here, I'm going to just show you guys that real quick. Yeah, so it's really strange, right? And this is on ESPN, and it's all across all these different websites. I'm sure you guys might have heard about it. But here, Patriots owner Robert Kraft facing charges of soliciting a prostitute, right? And this is not fake news, you know what I mean? This is real shit that's going on. New England Patriots owner Robert Kraft is facing charges of misdemeanor solicitation of prostitution after he was twice videotaped paying for a sex act at an illicit massage parlor, police in Florida said Friday. You know, obviously karma is not on this guy's side, you know what I mean? Well, as far as the Super Bowl goes, he won, but by like that much, right? But besides that, shit's just not going his way. And I think, and this is just my firm belief, I feel that a lot of other companies and CEOs and very high up, high profile individuals are going to be sought after from the government when it comes to money, for whatever reason, because they want to pay down the national debt. And the only way to really do that is to go after the people with the most money, you know, and this is one of those people. You know what I mean? And the SEC is a branch of the government. And what are we seeing? Government shutdowns. And what do you think the government's going to do to stay afloat? Anything necessary. Even if that means throwing his ass under the bus, bankrupting him, bankrupting his company, it doesn't matter. You know, as long as the government stays afloat, that's what matters the most. And I think that's a really narrow-minded and selfish way to think about this. Because if the governments of the world were doing their job and looking out for the people, you know, of their country, not just the top 1%ers of their country, but if they were actually looking out for their people, then we wouldn't be in this mess right now. So That's just my thoughts on this. I don't know what you guys think. I would appreciate your thoughts down below. I'm sure you guys are tired of hearing me. My cat is falling asleep, as she always does in my other videos. And yeah, if you guys have any questions, you're more than welcome to email me, message me, leave a comment. I would love you guys. Subscribe, and you can look forward to a lot more content coming your way from me. I appreciate you guys to the fullest. You guys are the best audience anyone could ever ask for. And I just want to give a really quick shout out. You know, this video has gone on forever, so what the hell, what difference would a shout out make, right? I just want to shout out to Salivate Metal. I want to shout out to Truth Never Told. I want to shout out to SGT Report. I want to shout out to Jeremiah Babe. I believe he's like one of the greatest, you know, speakers when it comes to this stuff. He's like a mentor. You know what I mean? He shares a lot of knowledge, and he actually looks into things. So, you know, I give kudos to him the most out of anybody. Not just him, but like Silver Report Uncut. He's also a great guy. He looks into things. He does his due diligence. He researches things, cross-references everything. And I believe that's the only way you can really do business these days, because you can't just take somebody's word at face value anymore. You have to look, and you have to see for yourself. So again, this is Felonious Bitcoin. I love you guys. Please like, subscribe, and take care, guys. Stay safe, and God bless you all. Brother, it's caught in the crossfire.